Once again, I want to welcome you to our service this morning. Thank you for taking the time to be with us this Sunday morning. And we are continuing with our theme of equipping the body of Christ so that it can be effective in their own, not just in their personal life, but also in the ministry that God has called us on into as individuals. Now, there are two types of people in this world, two types. Okay? Those who want to see, those who want to get things done, and those who don't want to make mistakes. Okay? Two types of people. People who want to get things done. They just want to get things done. Regardless of how they get it done, they just want to get it done. And there are some people who don't ever want to make mistakes. Now, for those who want to get things done, they understand that if they are going to move forward, they will make mistakes as they move along. They know that. That if they are going to get anything done in life, they will make mistakes. That if they're able to get anything done in life, there are times when they will miss their steps. There are times when they will misunderstand certain things. There are times when they will not fully understand what is going on, but yet they will move forward. There will be mistakes in their life. They understand that. But the problem is that for those who don't want to make mistakes in life, what they have effectively done for themselves is this. They have effectively limited their opportunity for moving forward. Because if you wait for everything to be perfect, if you wait till you understand everything before you move forward, if you wait till the conditions are perfect, you are going to wait a very long time. Okay? You're going to wait a very long time. And what will happen is that you might not be able to move forward. Last week, I told you that one of the ways in which one of our goals as a church is to be able to equip believers to do what? To be effective in their personal lives and in their ministry. And if we are going to effectively equip Christians to be effective in their personal life and in their walk with the Lord, we said the first thing we need to do is to be able to challenge them to dream so that they can see a possible future. They can see what God has made available for them. They can see what is possible outside of the realm of the physical that they can see right now. They should be able to see into the supernatural and see what God can make available.
Yeah.
Okay? It is when you are able to see that, that is when you are able to move from where you are to where you need to be. I said that is the only way you can grow personally. That's why the only way you can grow your ministry. The man who built most of the people who built most of the things that we see today, it was because they were able to see beyond what they were looking at that point in time. That's why they're able to build it. And I refer to something I used to call something the law of double creation. The law of double creation simply means that unless you are able to conceive it, unless you are able to see it in the spiritual, you cannot see it in the physical. The architect who built or who designed this particular building must first of all see this building in his mind. If he's not able to see it in his mind, he will not be able to put it on paper. If he cannot put it on paper, the designers, the building engineers cannot build this thing. The same thing, if we are going to move from where we are to where we need to be as individual, as a family, as a church, as a community, as a nation, we need to be able to receive a picture of a desired future. We need to be able to see a picture of a desired future. And that's basically what we're talking about. That's basically what we talked about last week. And I remember saying that where there is a dream, there is always a hope. Where there is a dream, there is always a hope. Where there is hope, there is always faith. And where there is faith, all things are possible. Because if you believe you can fly, you might probably need to take Prozac. Or go to Clover Bottom. But I don't believe anybody can fly here. But the point is that if you believe you can do something, if you believe you can do something, then you know that you have the ability to do it. You know? You know that you are able to do those things because what happened? It energizes you. It strengthens you. Okay? There was a story that was told of a particular city in Maine, in the state of Maine. We were told that there was a dam that was to be built in that city. A dam was supposed to be built in that city. And the residents were paid to relocate because when they build the dam, that particular city will be flooded by water. So they paid the residents to relocate. And you know the interesting thing that happened is this. As soon as the residents were paid and they received money, what happened is that they stopped taking care of the city. And the city started dying. Okay? The city started dying. Even before the city was flooded, the city died. Wow. All right? Where there is no dream, there is no hope. Where there is no hope, there is no faith. And where there is no faith, there is no possibility of anything. Because if you don't believe you can do it, why try in the first place? If you don't believe that you can do it, why waste your time? said it before and I'll say it again. If you don't believe God can hear and answer prayer, why waste your time praying? Why? I mean, why should you be talking to God if you know he doesn't answer you? You know? It's not like I know that if I know that my wife is not going to talk to me because she's angry at me for something, why would I want to talk to her? You know? The whole idea is that unless you believe, unless there is a faith, unless you know that there is something that is about to happen in your life, that is what energizes you to move forward. That is what energizes, that's what strengthens you. That is what gives you the hope. That's what gives you the faith to be able to step ahead. In Romans chapter 4, Romans chapter 4, reading from verse number 3, the Bible tells us there. He said, for what saith the scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. You know, many of us, at one point in time, we have heard about the story of Abraham, right? If you have gone to school, if you have gone to church, for even just for one day, you have heard about Abraham. Abraham, the father of our faith. Now, the Bible introduced us to Abraham in the book of Genesis chapter 11. In Genesis 11 verse 26, the Bible says that when Terah had lived 70 years, he became the father of Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Okay, in chapter 12 of Genesis, we began to see the interactions and the dealings of God with the life of Abraham. In Genesis chapter 12, reading from verse 1, the Bible tells us, now the Lord has said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto the land that I will show thee. And I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and I will curse them that curse thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Now, if you look at that Romans chapter, if you look at that verse number 2 again of that Genesis 12, if you read verse 2 again, the Bible tells us there, he said, I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and I will make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Now, if you read that verse of the scripture, that is the dream, that is the picture. That is the picture of a possible future that God is giving to Abraham. God is saying, this is where you are right now. But later in life, this is what I am going to make you to be. He painted a picture for Abraham to say, this is what you are going to look like in the future. Okay? This is the possible future that God has promised Abraham. Please note that receiving the dream is not enough. It's not enough for you to just see a possible future. It's not enough for you to dream about a possible future. It's not enough to receive a promise of a possible future. Before Abraham can see the possible future, before Abraham can realize what God has promised unto him, he must be able to believe that dream. If God tells you, I'm going to do something in your life, if God says, I'm going to bless you, if God says, I'm going to heal you, if God says, I'm going to deliver you, it is meaningless if you don't believe it. It's meaningless. Unless you believe it, okay, Abraham's possible future will never happen if Abraham never believed it. The same thing, whatever God has spoken into your life at the beginning of this year, is not going to happen if you don't believe it. If you don't believe it. Because if I tell somebody right now, all you have to do is come to downtown Nashville at 12 o'clock tomorrow morning and you will receive a check of $1 million. If you don't believe it, you're not going to leave your house. So look at this African man. He doesn't even have the money. He wants to give you $1 million. Come on. You know, you don't believe me, so you won't get out of your house. But if you believe me that I'm able to give $1 million check and I will give it to you at 12 noon at downtown, what happens? You will get there before 12 o'clock.
Yes.
Because you believe that I can give you. Because you believe that I have that kind of money. Okay? Now, you can imagine if it was the president that promised you $1 million. What happened? Everybody will line up there. Why? Because they believe he has the money, he can give it out. But if an African man like me gives us, just get away, man. This guy. you're asking for offering every Sunday. You want to give me $1 million? Come on, forget about it. So, but the point we are making is this. The promise that God had made unto Abraham. The promise he made unto Abraham. That promise can only come to pass if Abraham believed. That's number one. Number two, that promise can only happen if Abraham believed the person who spoke the promise. Mm-hmm. Okay? If you believe the person who spoke the promise, that is when the promise will happen. It's not just believing the promise. Because if you believe this, yes, I can give you the money. If you don't believe me as an individual, that I am faithful enough to do it, that I'm trustworthy enough to do it, that I have the capacity to give you that kind of money, you will not believe it. So it is one thing. You have to believe, first of all, the promise. Number two, that you believe the giver of the promise. Now, number three, he must believe that God is able to fulfill it.
Yes.
I might have a good intention of giving you money. I might have the good intention of helping you out. But the question is, do I have the money? And the answer, you know already. I don't have $1 million to give you. If I have $1 million, I'm sure you will not be sitting in this kind of a place. I can bet you. You will not sit in this kind of a place. You will be sitting in a very glorious cathedral. But that is a different story for another day. The point we are making is that you have to, first of all, believe the promise. Then you believe the person who is giving the promise. Then you have to believe that the person has the capacity or the ability to be able to fulfill the promise that they have made. And then he must also believe in his ability to trust and walk with God in the process of believing him. In other words, do I have enough faith to hold on to this man, to wait for that promise to be fulfilled? Because one thing we fail to understand is this: the fact that God gave you a promise today does not mean it's going to happen tomorrow. God follows his own timetable.
That's right.
And that is another story for another day. But the thing is that he must believe. For Abraham, for the dream to happen in the life of Abraham, he must believe, number one, the dream. He must believe the giver of the dream. He must believe that the giver of the dream has the ability to fulfill that dream. And he must also believe in his own ability to trust and walk with God in the process of fulfilling that dream. And finally, he must be ready to act on the dream. He must be willing to act. In other words, the $1 million check that I'm going to give to you, even if I write it right now, I have the ability to give it. I am willing to give it. I am faithful to give it. If you don't stretch forth your hand, I'm not going to force it into your hand. I hope you know that. It's not going to happen. You must stretch forth your hands to receive it. And that is what the Bible tells us in the book of Joshua chapter 1. It says that wherever the sole of your feet shall tread upon, there I have given unto you. In other words, if the sole of your feet does not tread upon anything, you are getting nothing. Simple mathematics. If you multiply $1 million by zero, you will get what? Zero. It doesn't make it. So unless Abraham is willing and ready to act, unless you are willing to get up and do something, unless you are willing to put your feet to the faith, you know, put faith to your feet or feet to your faith or whatever you want to do, you know, if you are willing to do something, the promise of God will not just happen. God does not expect you to sit and put your life on cruise control. Okay? And then the car just keep going and you just relax and just chill and then God start pouring blessing. It does not work like that. It doesn't work like that. Okay? You have to be engaged in the process. You have to be engaged in the process. So for Abraham to see the promise that God has promised him, he must be willing, he must be ready to act upon that promise. He must be willing to act and ready. But remember, everything starts with the ability to be able to believe God. Because if you don't believe God, you are not going to get off your butt. If you don't believe God, you are not going to move. If you don't believe God, you are not going to even trust Him. You won't even want to entertain any other thought. Everything starts with believing in God. Then it follows with believing ourselves. And then believe, you know, not only in the possible future, but in the realization of that possible future. There is something we used to say back home. That when the Lord is blessing Mr. A and blessing Mr. B, do not make my own case an impossible case. In other words, there are times when you go into a particular environment and you see people receiving blessings, people receiving all sorts of things. And then by the time the individual comes and stops and stays in line, they tell you that that particular item is finished. That will not be our portion in Jesus' name. But the Lord will make it possible that when He is blessing everybody around us, our own blessing will not be an illusion in Jesus' name. Now, it is not enough to see a possible future, but we must believe in the possibility of the realization of that future. In other words, that yes, people can be promoted. You must not only believe that God can promote, but you must believe that God can promote you. You must not only believe that God can heal, but you must believe that God can heal you. You must not only believe that God can deliver, but you must believe that God can deliver you. If people are winning the lottery, you cannot just say, oh, other people will win it. You must also believe that you too, you can also win it. In other words, what God is doing for everybody, you must believe that it is possible also in your own life. Because if you don't believe it's possible in your life, what happens is that you will clap for other people, but you will not expect it for yourself. And that is why you see people come to church. And you will notice that the people that receive miracles in the church are the first time or second time visitors. Because the people who are in the church are already so used to the messages in the church. We are so used to the way things are done in the church. We are so familiar with God that when God is moving, we don't even recognize him anymore. But you find that the people who are new to the kingdom, the people who are new to the whole thing, the people who are new to church, when God is moving, they realize because they've not seen it before, so they embrace it and they receive the miracle. I pray our own miracle will not elude us in Jesus' name. But you must not only believe that it is possible, believe that it is possible in your own life.
Yeah.
Okay? Let's go back to Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, I want us to read from verse number 18 now. Romans chapter 4, reading from verse number 18. The Bible tells us, say, who against hope believed in hope that he might become the father of many nations according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Okay? From this verse of the scripture, you will see that Abraham believed God. Abraham believed God when there was no reason to believe God. Abraham believed God when there was no reason to believe God. Look at that verse number 18. He said, who against hope believed in hope? In other words, there was no hope for him. There was no possibility of anything happening. The Bible says, who against hope, Abraham believed. Abraham believed God when there was no reason to believe God. The same thing in your life. If you want to see God move on your behalf, you believe God even when you don't have any reason to believe. Number two, how do we see the miracle of God operating in our life? Abraham believed God when it was ridiculous to believe God. Look at that same chapter of the Bible. The Bible says, and that he might become the father of many nations. According to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. This is a 75-year-old man, maybe a 100-year-old man. The wife is almost 90. These people are not able to do anything that look like having children anymore. But the Bible says that they continue to believe God, even when it was ridiculous. You see an 80-year-old woman and you are walking up and down. You see an 80-year-old man, you can't even stand upright and you say you still want to have children. You say, Baba, Habba, take it easy now. You can't do this thing anymore. You understand the idea? When it was ridiculous to believe God, he continued to believe God. Number three, Abraham believed God when it was impossible to believe God. You look at the condition of Sarah. You look at his own physical condition. You know it's not going to happen. Under any laws of science, it will not happen. But he has for. But people, when people look at it like that, they forget that this same God is the God that makes creative miracles. He's the one that turns things around. And when when things are impossible, Abraham believed God. And it began to happen. The Bible says, he considered not his own body now dead. His own body was now dead. When he was about 100 years old, he still believed that God would give him a child. At 100, he still believed. So Abraham believed God when it was impossible to believe God. Abraham believed God when it was irrational to believe God. Mm-hmm. When it was irrational to believe God. The Bible says, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. It's not just his own problem now. They have double problem. He is old. His wife is old. His wife, I mean, I think when you get to a certain age, they call the same for women, they call it menopause. Sarah has gone beyond menopause. Mm-hmm. If there's another word, yes, that's where she is right now. It's not happening for her anymore. But the Bible says that they continue to believe. Even when faith is irrational, you continue to believe. Despite all this odd, Abraham still believed God. Now, if we are going to lift up our own lives, if we are going to lift up our own families, if we are going to lift up our own churches, we must understand, it is not enough for you to dream, but you must be able to believe that your dream can come true. We must be able to see, you must be able to see beyond what you are seeing right now. You must be able to trust God. There was a particular guy who said this, I think it was John Maxwell, who said, to a belief is more than just an idea, that a person possesses. It is an idea that possesses an individual. It's not for you to just say, I believe something. When you say somebody believes something, your belief will motivate your action. If I believe that this particular chair is strong enough to carry me, how do I demonstrate that this chair can carry me? It is when I sit down. If I don't sit down, I don't believe it. I can say it, but I don't believe it. Your faith, your statement of belief is a function of your action. So what you believe is what possesses you. Number two, to believe is to accept as true or real the things that God has said about you. To believe is to have a confidence or trust that you will be able to see the future that God has spoken concerning you. The result of what you have accepted as true or the confidence that you have now propels you into action. If you believe God, you act on his word. If you believe God, you act on his word. So you see, if you are not confident of the things that God has said about you, it will show in your action. It will show in the things that you do. And if you look at the book of Proverbs chapter 23, Proverbs 23, reading from verse number 7, the Bible says, as a man thinks, so he is. In other words, what is going on inside of you is basically what is happening, is what that's who you are. Okay? You become on the outside what you believe on the inside. Okay? If you believe the whole world is against you, you will act like that. If you believe that the whole world loves you, you will behave like that also. And that's why you see some people, when they move around, it's always sunshine. And when you see some people, they are always very angry. It's not because anything is happening. It's what is happening inside of them. The Bible says, as a man thinks, so he is. That is why believing what God has said about you is very, very important, because number one, it determines everything. Yes. It determines everything that happens to you. Whatever you believe about what God has said to you determines everything that happens to you, because the Bible tells in the book of Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6, it says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Number two, believing what God has said about you determines your relationship with him. Because if you don't believe him, it's just like I tell you, I'm going to give you something, and you don't believe me. How can we have a good relationship if you don't even believe me? If you don't believe me, you will not be here this morning. If you don't believe that God has given us a mandate as a church, you will not come into this place. You will not subject yourself to it. It is your faith that determines your relationship with God and with your fellow man. Because you believe that person. Because you trust that person to a certain level. That is why you have a relationship with them. Without faith, it is impossible to please him. Mm-hmm. Number three, believing what God has said to you determines your expectation. Mm-hmm. It determines what you expect from God. If you don't believe that God has the ability to help you, you don't expect anything from him. Okay? But if you believe that God that owns the heavens and the earth, the one that owns the cattle on the thousand hill, if you believe that particular God, then you expect him to do something for you. But if you don't believe him, you don't expect anything. You don't believe him, you don't expect anything. For he that will come, look at that Hebrews chapter 11 again. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Believing what God has said about you determines your expectation. The Bible says, blessed are those, sorry, not the Bible now, one of the founding fathers of this country. He said, blessed are those who do not expect anything, for they shall not be disappointed. If you are not expecting anything, you will never be disappointed, because you're not going to get anything. Okay? Blessed are those who do not expect nothing, who do not expect anything, for they shall not be disappointed. But those who are expecting God to do something in their life, they too will not be disappointed, because God will do something in their life. You cannot live in a way that is inconsistent with your expectation. You cannot tell me, I don't expect anything, and then your life, you cannot live it. The way you live your life cannot be inconsistent with your expectation. If you are trusting God to do something for you, it will show in the way you behave. It will show in the way you pray. It will show in the way you study your word, you study the word of God. It will show in the way you live your life. But if you're not expecting God to do anything, you live a careless life. So you cannot live in a way that is inconsistent with your expectation. Believing what God has said about you also determines your attitude. A man who is expecting a big amount of windfall, immediately you see him, you can see he's happy, because he knows something is coming. And that's why if you look at some of the men, and when we're growing up and in those days, when people live from paycheck to paycheck, when towards the end of the month, you can see the man, whistling the house, because he knows he's going to get paid. But as soon as the money is finished, and that's when you see his eyes has changed. If you don't put food on the table at the right time, he becomes very, very angry. You know, he becomes like the Snickers commercial. You know, he becomes a different person. The idea is that when you are expecting something good, it changes your mood. You are happy. If you don't expect anything, and you sit down, you say, how am I going to pay the rent? How am I going to pay the car note? How am I going to pay this one? How am I going to pay that? If the child makes a mistake and crosses your path at that point in time, that child is in trouble because he can get whacked. Yeah? The reason is because you are not expecting anything. But if you are expecting a good windfall, and the money is coming, and you know the money is going to come, and you know it's going to be bigger than what you expect, even if the child is misbehaving, say, don't worry, I'll buy you ice cream, I'll buy you donut, I'll buy you everything, because you know he's expecting money. So what you believe about God determines your attitude in life. It determines your attitude. A man is happy when he knows something is coming, and a man is disappointed when he knows that there's nothing is going to show up. Believing what I said about you also determines the kind of action you take. Okay? Determines your action you take. There was a particular songwriter back in Nigeria then. This young man, he wrote a song. He said that, I'm trying to see how I can translate this now from the language into English now. He said that when the month is about to come to an end, he said you see the young man who is working for the government. He said at that point in time, you will see the kind of places he will visit. He will visit the people who are selling food on the right side of the road. That's when he'll be asking to be put on credit. He said, but eventually when he gets his money, the day he gets paid at the office, when he walks to that particular restaurant, he tells me, I need 5 pieces of meat. I need a bottle of this. I need a bottle of that. He's making that noise because he has money in his pocket. But when there is no money in his pocket, what happened? He just say, don't worry. I don't think I need that today. I think I'm going on diet tomorrow, because he doesn't have the money. But as soon as he has the money, he will forget about dieting. He will forget about healthy living. At that point in time, he will be taking, everything will be going on well for him. The idea will take, what I'm trying to say is that what you believe or what you are expecting determines the kind of action that you take. Yeah. It determines the kind of action you take. You can tell when the man of the house has money. You can tell. You can tell. He promised you everything. He promised you everything. And he's never angry. You see him happy. He will be happy when he has money in his pocket. But when there is no money in the bank account, you can tell the man of the house also. You can tell. His eyes will be unnecessarily red. He'll be angry for no reason, you know? And he will just be, you just don't want to come near him at that point in time. It's not because of anything. He's not angry at you. It's just because he doesn't have money in his pocket. That's the problem. So, my brothers, don't be angry with me. All the men in the house, don't be. And I'm sure our sisters also understand already. They know that when we don't have money, we behave in a very interesting way. But that's a story for another day. So, but what you believe about God determines the actions that we take. Now, if you don't believe it, you know, you cannot, you know, if you cannot see it, you can't believe it. You cannot believe it, you can't have it. Okay? What you expect of God also determines the kind of results that you get from Him. Mm. What you expect from God determines the kind of results you get from Him. I used to tell people that hope is not a strategy. Okay? Hope is not a strategy. If you want good results, you need to perform good actions. That's right. If you want to see something happen in your life, you have to be involved in the process. You say, I hope to get this. No, hope is not a strategy. Hope is just something that you just, you know, is an exercise of faith that has no basis. But that's another story for another day. Okay? So what you believe in God also determines your accomplishments. What you believe about God determines your accomplishments. Now, the first obstacles to success for most people is not their inability to see their future, it's their inability to believe in themselves to be able to achieve what God says He will do for them. Your potential is the picture that God has, you know, is a picture of what you can become if you apply yourself. Okay? The potential is what you can become if you apply yourself. So how then do we equip ourselves so that we can put these things in perspective? How do we equip ourselves, equip our church, equip our community? You know, we do that when we challenge them to believe in God. You have to be able to trust God enough to see that God will come to your aid. Number two, how do we equip ourselves? We challenge ourselves to believe in God and to believe in ourselves. You have to believe, because one thing you want to understand is that God walks in the instrumentality of people. God can save everybody today if He wants to save us. Okay? But he chose not to do that. He chose to give us the opportunity to be able to accept the true love. The angels could have preached the gospel from heaven, but God did not give them an assignment. Why? Because he wanted individuals to do it. So if you are going to see God move on your behalf, well, number one, you have to believe God. Number two, you have to believe in yourself. Number three, you have to believe in the people that God has placed in your life. Because it is not possible for any one person to do it alone. It is not possible. Anywhere or anything that is important and is worth doing, anything that will be of great value, cannot be done by one single person. I can assure you that. You need people around you. You have to believe in the people around us. And then number four, you have to believe in the purpose of God for your life. The question is, where does God want you? What is God putting in your heart? If you don't believe you are able to do those things, then you will not be able to do it. For those of us who have been here earlier on, you'll probably hear me talk about this church. This particular church was supposed to be in existence 13 years ago. Okay? But because of fear and because of not being able to sure of what God, of you know, not sure of the purposes and where God is taking us, we decided to delay, continue to delay, continue to delay, continue to delay. But the idea, what I'm saying is that if we are going to move from where we are to where we need to be, you need to not just believe in God, believe in yourself, believe in the people around you. You have to also believe in the purpose and the call that God has placed upon your life. Every one of us here, God is giving you an assignment. There is an assignment in your life. There is something that he has placed in your life that somebody else around you needs. There is something that he has blessed you with that you can bless the life of another person with. Unless you are confident, unless you believe that that thing is useful to somebody else, you will not use it. You remember the parable of the talent. The Bible said that the master, when he was leaving, he gave one 5, he gave one 2, and he gave one 1. And the Bible says that the man that had 5 took that 5, valued that 5, and began to invest with that 5. And at the end of the day, he got another 5, which makes it 10. The one with 2 walked with it and got 2. But the one that had that one single one was not able to value it. Maybe it's the ability to pray. Maybe it's the ability to help other people. Maybe it's just the ability to listen to other people. Maybe it's just the encouragement. You know, that person began to say, oh, because I don't look like this African man who knows how to preach, then well, I'm going to keep my gift. He took his own gift and buried it. And the Bible says that when the master came, he said, where is my gift? Where is that particular token that I've given unto you? He said, he had buried it. He said, well, you should have actually given it to the money changers. If you give it to put it in the bank so I can get an interest. The point the Lord is saying is this: you have to value the things that God has put in your hand. What is in your hand? If you remember in the Old Testament, the Bible tells us about Elisha. This particular widow woman had a husband who was a priest, and the husband died. He didn't have any money. And this particular woman was dying of hunger and was about to be taken into slavery. The two sons that she had, those two sons were about to be taken into captivity. And the prophet came and said, what is in your hand? This woman said nothing. She said, are you kidding me? What is in your hand? The woman said, well, we have a bottle of oil in the house. He said, then bring that bottle of oil. Who will expect that the bottle of oil will be her salvation? Nobody knew that. But the prophet said, bring that bottle of oil. Take empty pots and begin to pour that oil. And as you pour it, begin to fill the pot. Begin to fill the pot. And the Bible says that that particular woman, that woman filled several pots until she had no more pots. That was when the oil ceased. The point we are making is this: the things that God has placed in your life, there's somebody who needs it. Unless you are willing to pour that thing out of your life, you might not be able to continue to move forward. The breakthrough that many of us are looking for might be as a result of you not, you know, might be delayed as a result of you not pouring your life into other people. If we live unto ourselves, we will die unto ourselves. But if we live our lives that it will touch the life of somebody else, what you will find is that your life becomes richer the more life you touch. So how do we challenge ourselves to be able to become better in the things that God has given unto us? Number one, you believe in God. Number two, you believe in your own ability. Number three, you believe in the people around you. And number four, you believe in the purpose of God for our lives. You believe in the purpose of God for our lives. Abraham believed God. That's what the Bible says. And it was counted unto him for righteousness. So why don't we do it? That's the question. Why don't we believe in God? Why don't we believe in ourselves? Why don't we believe in the people around us? Why don't we believe in our purposes? Why? Okay? Why must we do it? In most cases, many of us don't believe because of fear. Mm-hmm. You're afraid what of people will say. I am an example of that. I told you it took this one 12 years. Number one of the fear that I have was, what are people going to say about me? that this African man, you came to Nashville, you want to come and start a church. I was afraid of what people would say. And that is what is stopping some people. Some people are afraid because they don't know how to do it. Some people are afraid because they don't have enough support and the people to around them. Some people are just afraid just because they don't believe God enough. They don't believe that God will be able to support them. Okay? Some people are afraid because they don't have the people around them. Others are afraid just because of the fact that they feel that they are not competent enough. If you ask most people, why don't you share your faith? You say, I don't know what to say. Who told you you don't know what to say? Who told you you don't know what to say? All you have to say, this is what I was before and this is what I am now. That's all. That's preaching the gospel. If I ask you how can you tell me how peanut butter sandwich, how it tastes like, you don't have to say, I don't know how to do peanut butter sandwich commercial. All you have to say is that you take the bread, you put it in the middle, and that's the end of the story. You have just testified. That is basically what it is. Many of us don't know what to say. That's why we don't know what to do. That's how we don't know how to move forward. Many of us are afraid of what people will say. Many of us are ashamed because many of us are embarrassed. But the most important thing we need to understand is that we must understand that unless you are willing to believe God, you will not be able to move forward. And when you believe God, it does certain things for you. And that's what we are going to do to round up this morning. When you believe God, what does it do? It empowers you. When you believe God, it empowers you. Number two, it encourages you because you know that God in heaven is speaking. You know, you have the resources of heaven available to you. When you believe God, it enlarges you. It enlarges you. Okay? Many of us are here today. If it not for the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we will never meet each other. If it is not for the name of Jesus that brought us all together under one roof, many of us will never know each other. So when you believe in God, what it does for you, it enlarges your coast. Number four, when you believe in God, it emboldens you. It emboldens you. You can imagine if somebody like Joshua, your little boy, if he's going to school and he has a bully, okay? Somebody keep bullying that boy, bullying him every time he goes to school so that he becomes afraid of going to school. If one day, just one day, you decide to go with him to school, he's going in front and you are behind him. You're just walking casually behind him. When, just imagine Joshua seeing that boy that is bullying him. Do you think he's going to be afraid? No. The reason is because daddy is behind me. You understand the idea? And because daddy is behind me, he can look at that boy that is bullying him and actually shakara that boy. Sorry. I don't know how to translate that word I just used into English. He can try to respond to the challenge of that boy because he has the father behind him. Okay? Can you now imagine if you are conscious of the fact that God is constantly behind you? You can go into the camp of the enemy and make a declaration because you know God is behind you. You can say the things that you can say because you know God is behind you. You can know because the devil is like that bully that is bullying that little boy. And the father is right behind him. Okay? So when you see that bully, say, hey, you cannot do me anything today. You know? The reason is because he knows that the father is right behind him. And because he knows the father is right behind him, he can say anything. He can do anything. He can even begin to put some swag in his, you know, in the way he walks. Just because he knows the father is behind him. The same thing for Christians. When we believe God, it emboldens us. It emboldens us. We can say what we need to say. We can do what we need to do because we know that there is a God that is behind us who is able to do all things. Not only that, when you believe God, it enlarges your vision. It opens your eyes to see what you have never seen before. It gives you vision. It gives you insight into the supernatural. It opens your eyes to see what you have never seen before. When you believe God, not only that, when you believe God, it has a way to be able to encourage your heart. When things are going sideways, you can begin to see that this God will begin to show you that this is not the end of the story. That this is not the end of the story. That's why you can believe God for the impossible. You can believe God for all the things that are unimaginable. That is what happened to Abraham. Because he knew that there was a God behind him. He believed God even when he knew that he was too old to have children. He still believed God. If you continue to read in the book of Genesis, you will find that even when God asked him for the impossible, when God asked him for a difficulty, when God said, go and kill your son, the Bible says that he knew that God was able to raise him from the dead and he was willing to take care of that. The point we're making is that when you believe God, it emboldens you, it strengthens you, it enlarges you, it gives you a new vision, it takes you to a new height. You can imagine, I mean, if you are hanging out with me, you will only see the people that I'm able to have connection with. Now imagine you are hanging out with the mayor of this city. It takes you to a different level. Now imagine you are hanging out with the governor of this state. It takes you to a different level. Now imagine you are hanging out with the president of this country. It takes you to a different level. What we are saying is that the more you hang out with God, the more you see from a different perspective. Open your eyes to see what you have never seen before. So the question is, do we believe God? Do we believe that God is faithful to do what he said he's going to do in our lives? Do we believe that God can give us that particular request that we have been asking of him? Do you believe that God can take you from where you are right now to where you need to be? Do you believe that God can give you the healing that you have been asking for? Do you believe that he can break that cycle of ignorance, that cycle of lack, that cycle of want, that cycle of insufficiency in our life? Do we believe God that he can do what you have been asking him for? Because if you don't believe him, it will be very difficult to do anything. And if you have your Bible, I want you to open the scripture so that we read that verse before we pray this morning. It's in the book of Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11, and the Bible tells us there, it says, but without faith, that is another word, if you don't believe God, it will be impossible to walk with him. Hebrews 11 verse 6. Hebrews 11 verse 6 is on page 210. I like that. I just like doing that, you know. I just enjoy doing things like that. Anyway, just look at the pages in your own scripture, but in my own page, I think it's 211. Anyway, Hebrews 11 verse 6, the Bible says, without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder of those of them that diligently seek him. He that comes to God must believe that he is. Okay? He that comes to God must believe that he is. Many of us, I'm sure, we are not in church. If you came to church today, you believe that there is a God. But look at the second part. He said that, and he is the rewarder of those that diligently seek him. The diligence in seeking the Almighty God means in obeying the things that he has told us to do. The question now is that, do we believe God for the things that he has spoken concerning our lives? Do you believe him for the little things in your life? Do you believe him for your family? Do you believe him for provision? Do you believe him for sustenance? Do you believe him for visitation? Because if you don't, it will show in the way you behave. But if you do, it will be reflected in the things that you receive. Let's bow our heads and talk to the Almighty God. Remember the verse of the scripture we started praying with. The Bible said that if he can give us Jesus, what else can he not give us? If he can give Jesus to die for our sins, what else can he not give us? I want you to talk to the Almighty God. The grace to believe him. The grace to believe him. Lord, give unto me in the name of Jesus. The grace to believe the Almighty God. The grace to trust him. Father, give unto me in the name of Jesus.